Eternal God, our Father, we are so glad that we can come together in this place today at this hour to experience your presence, because you care for each one of us deeply. You care about everything that happens to us. Most of all, you have shown that by sending your precious, innocent Son, Jesus, to die for our sins, to pay the price we could never pay. And so, Father, if you were willing to do that, then certainly you care about everything that is going on in our lives, especially our hurts and burdens. And we know that in this gathering today, there are those who are hurting, whatever the reason, whatever the circumstances, whatever the details, but you know them all. And most of all, you care about each person. And so we pray that in this time together, that our hearts, not only our ears, but our hearts also will be attuned to you, that we will let your Spirit speak to us and call us to faith in Christ so that we can trust you for all things. Thank you for Jesus. Bless us now as we worship him together. We pray in his precious name. Amen. Is leading us in worship and preparing us for our observance of the Lord's Supper. We want you to join us as we sing hymn number 265. You will see that this is a short and simple praise type song, and we're going to actually sing it twice. When you find page 265, you will see the same words in the first two lines as well as in the bottom three lines. And so we will just sing straight down the page, but there will be a pause briefly after we sing those first two lines before we repeat it at the bottom. Number 265, Hallelujah, Praise the Lamb. Please stand with us. right. Good morning. It's so good to see you. We're going to do a little magic trick here in just a few minutes. But I want you to think about this. Some things just seem that they can't really happen. Some things seem, as we would think about it, to be impossible. But you know, the Bible says this about God. When we think about all the possible things that can happen, all the wonderful things sometimes that do happen, the Bible says with God, nothing is impossible. And so, God controls the world. He made everything in it. He made us. We talked last week about the changing seasons. We're just about that time of the year when the leaves and everything will be changing. And we'll see all of that in God's creation and nature around us. But more importantly than the big things that are so obvious that God can do that don't seem possible are the things He can do for us and in our own hearts and our lives. Because we all face all kinds of situations. As you get older, you're going to find yourself dealing with all sorts of things. And many of them are tough and difficult. Life is not easy. Some things make us afraid that happen. Some things make us sad. Some things make us unsure about what we're going to do and how we're going to get through a situation. But remember, with God, nothing is impossible. And so He wants us to come to Him and to ask Him for His help in everything that we're facing. He can do what none of us can do. And He wants to do that for us. Most of all, He sent His Son Jesus. That seems impossible. Someone would come and die for us to pay for our sins. And that's what the Lord's Supper is all about, that we'll be observing a little bit later. So thinking about all that, we have this little magic trick here today. So I've got a quarter, I've got this little plastic tray, and this drinking glass from home that's pretty much clear. So you can see inside the glass. So what we're going to do with your help is, we're going to make this real quarter pass through the glass and end up on the tray below. All right? You think that's impossible? Anybody think you can do it with me? Say yes. You know you can. Okay. We're going to make this happen, all right? Doesn't seem that it could. It doesn't seem that there's any way this quarter can pass through this real glass, but I'm going to need your help. So we're going to count to three and then say Shazam. That's our magic word for today, okay? So you're going to count with me. One, two, three. We'll say Shazam, and we'll see if the impossible can happen and this quarter can go through the glass and end up on the tray, okay? So you ready? Count with me and then say it. One, two, three, Shazam. Well, I think we've got something here. Kinsley, make sure that's a real quarter. Is it? That looks like a real quarter. Okay, pass it around. Make sure everybody knows that's a real quarter. So it sure looked like you and I passed that quarter right through this glass. Of course, it didn't really happen. It just looked like it happened. So I can't do what's impossible. Only God can do what we think is impossible. And He loves us so much each and every day. In spite of who we are, in spite of anything that we do, God loves us. Let's thank Him for that before you go back to your seats, okay? Close your eyes, please. Dear God, thank You for loving us. Thank You for all the wonderful, powerful things that You do. We know we cannot begin to do those wondrous things, but You have all power. Nothing is impossible with You. Thank You most of all for Jesus, our Savior and friend. And now please bless these precious children, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. As we continue to think about our Savior's sacrifice for us, one of the great old hymns of the faith, number 255, At the Cross. We will sing the first, third, and fifth verses. 1, 3, and 5, number 255. Stand with us, please.
At the cross, at the cross, where
Let us pray together.
Heavenly Father, once again we come together as your children just to worship you and praise you. And we give thanks for all the many blessings you've bestowed on each person here today. Thank you for the sunshine and the cooler weather you've given us. And we give you the praise and glory for that, because only you can, as Mickey said, can do wonderful things as the weather. And Father, we just ask that you bless us as we bring our gifts to you today. Father, we just ask you to put bless them as only you can. Bless the giver. And we give thanks because you've given us the ultimate gift in Jesus Christ. In his name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
as we continue to think along the lines of what Jesus has done for all of us who are guilty sinners before God, I call your attention to some words of the prophet Isaiah. And these words were given by the prophet several centuries before Jesus was even born. And he's speaking in the past tense, but he's speaking of one who would come several hundred years later. In Isaiah 53, I begin reading with verse 4. The prophet says, "Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed. All of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to a slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living for the transgression of my people to whom the stroke was due? His grave was assigned with wicked men, yet he was with a rich man in his death because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. But the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. If he would render himself as a guilt offering, he will see his offspring, he will prolong his days, and the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand." According to U.S. Census information, about 100 years ago, for a period, about 2.9 million babies were born every year here in the United States. That was a century ago. That was the average. That average held pretty well for the next several decades. And then came World War II. Everything changed in a lot of ways, including the population and birth rate here in America. All those servicemen who survived the war coming home, starting families, and so forth. And so the big baby boom occurred right after World War II for a number of years, and many of us in this room were a part of the boom. And as of today, we're told that approximately 4.1 million babies are born here in the United States each year. Thinking about birth, thinking about new life coming into the world, that's what the prophet Isaiah is discussing. And again, he is writing these words 700 years before the events. 7 centuries before Jesus was born, God's Spirit gave the prophet this understanding, this prediction and prophecy of something that was going to happen. And so, 7 centuries before, the prophet Isaiah predicted that a certain child would be born. He would be born to a virgin young girl, and he would be the servant of the Lord. In fact, Isaiah and others refer to this special one who would be born as the suffering servant. One suffering innocently for all the others who are guilty. The suffering servant. Isaiah goes on to say also that this one who would be born as the Lord's servant would become the ruler of the whole earth, which was a staggering claim and prediction. But between his birth and his rule over the world, this special one who would come would grow up and die a horrible death, but then rise from the dead. And in describing all of this, which Isaiah could not possibly fully understand, but God was giving him the words and the message and the truth to commit to writing and to speech. But Isaiah refers to the death of this innocent servant as the silence of the lamb. Look again at verse 7 if you still have your Bible open. Talking about Jesus who would come much later, he says, "He was oppressed and he was afflicted, Yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. And so, we're looking at the silence of the Lamb of God today as we prepare to worship through the Lord's Supper. Why is this statement made about Jesus? That he was silent before his accusers and before those who would take his life from him. I want us to consider two reasons why that Lamb was silent as he faced death for all of us. And here is the first one of those reasons. Jesus, the Lamb, was silent because he loved the real criminals. Now, you know the story of the crucifixion. You know that that day on that skull-shaped hill outside the walls of the city of Jerusalem, there was not one cross, but there were three. Jesus on the center cross, but on either side of him there were two men who were known criminals who had been convicted of various crimes. And now they were paying their price to society. They had been condemned to die. Rightfully so, they were guilty. And so each of these men was on one side of Jesus as they all three were hanging and dying together. And so here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, dying between these two obvious criminals. Yet, he died like a criminal, but he was guilty of no crime. You see, he was there that day. He knew that was his destiny, and he was willing to go voluntarily to the cross for all of us because he, the innocent one, loved the sinful, guilty, and condemned people like you and me. That's why the Lamb was silent and willing to die for us. And because of his love for us, in the verses that I read, Isaiah says again, 7 centuries before the fact, he said that Jesus became our substitute. Listen, if anybody should have died for my sin, it should have been me, because I am the guilty one. And you can say the same thing. But Jesus was willing to go there and literally take your place. Isaiah says he was our substitute. And then he was our sin offering. Throughout the Old Testament, God gave all kinds of commands and instructions about worship among his chosen people, the Jewish people. And there are so many details, so many exact things that had to be done in worship in order for God to be honored and for the people to be called to faith in him. And so God had given all kinds of detailed instructions about the different offerings and sacrifices to be brought to him. And Isaiah, in this passage of Scripture, refers to Jesus as our guilt offering. We're guilty, he was not. But he served as our guilt offering before a holy God. And then Isaiah goes on to say here that Jesus became our sin bearer. He bore our sins for us. There's a painting of the crucifixion by the master Rembrandt. And if you ever get to view a copy of that well-known painting, pay close attention to the details and the characters and figures portrayed in the scene. When you first would look at that painting, The Crucifixion by Rembrandt, of course your attention would be drawn immediately to the center of the painting, the cross and Jesus hanging and dying there. But then your attention might be drawn to other faces, faces in the crowd. And you would get to see some of the expressions at least depicted by Rembrandt on the faces of those who were participating in the horrible crime of killing the Son of God. A number of faces of people in the crowd can be seen. But then if you let your eyes drift over to one side of that picture, there you will find another figure. He's almost hidden in the shadows, but you can see his face. And that is a self-portrait of Rembrandt himself. He painted himself among the crowd at the crucifixion of Christ because he understood that because of his sins, he was guilty of helping to nail Jesus to his cross. And so are we all. Jesus bore our sins on his cross. So, one reason the Lamb was silent is because he loved the real criminals, all of us who are sinners. But there's another reason why the Lamb was silent. And this is one of the most astonishing things of all, and I hope you will follow me in this line of thought. The Lamb was also silent because he trusted his executioner. Now think with me carefully about this. Because here we come to one of the most shocking things recorded in the Bible. And frankly, it is disturbing, at least on the surface. Because this most shocking and disturbing thing answers the question, who really killed Jesus? Now you ponder that for a moment. Who really killed our Lord? Most of us would probably think that the killer of Christ was one of the usual suspects. The Jews, perhaps, because many of them had cried out for his death by crucifixion. We might think the Romans were truly guilty. After all, they were the ones who carried out the execution. Crucifixion was a Roman form of capital punishment, not a Jewish form. The Jews still practiced stoning to death. And so, a group of soldiers in the Roman army were sent to carry out the death sentence against Jesus. They actually nailed him to the cross. Or, when answering the question, who really killed Jesus, you might say Judas Iscariot, one of the 12. Who never was really a believer, and he sold and betrayed Jesus for just a handful of money. Or in answering the question, we might think the whole human race, all of us who are sinners. Or maybe our answer to that question, who really killed Jesus, would be Satan. It's obvious, the great enemy of God and all of us, Satan killed him. A good case can be made for all of those possibilities. But folks, the shocking truth is, and listen carefully, the shocking truth is, God the Father killed Jesus. The Bible says so right here and elsewhere. And so here we come to one of the deep mysteries of God's plan of salvation. And frankly, as I was preparing this message, I had to stop and sit and think and ponder for a long time about this. Could it be? Is it possible? Yes, in some way that our small human brains and minds can't fully grasp and comprehend, that's the way it was. Look again in our scripture passage that I read. Look at verse 4. Thinking ahead, 7 centuries before the events, writing in the past tense, Isaiah said, "He, the Lamb, was smitten of God and afflicted." Smitten of God. That means he was struck down by God. And then look in verse 6. The last part of verse 6. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. And then verse 10. And this really states it bluntly and clearly. Look at verse 10. But the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. What does this all mean? The Lord was pleased to crush him on the cross. It does not mean in any sense that God the Father enjoyed sending his Son to the cross to die for our sins. There could be no enjoyment in this. In fact, it was a heart-rending, heart-breaking thing for the Father to watch his Son die so horribly. And suffer terribly. But you see, all of that was necessary. And that's the point. The only thing that could satisfy the Father's justice was exactly what was done to Jesus. He paid the price for our sins. You see, the horrible death of the innocent Jesus was the Father's plan all along. It had to be this way. That was God's plan from the beginning. In fact, it was even God's plan from before the beginning. A portion of the New Testament expresses it this way. Jesus was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. What does that mean? Before the world, as we know it, was ever formed, before it was founded, before it was created, before there were any human beings here to commit a sin who needed a Savior, before any of that even came into existence, God in his heart and mind already knew. In the eternity of the past, God knew that there would be sinful human beings, all of us, who would need a Savior. And so before the first verse of the first chapter of the book of Genesis, in the beginning, God created. Before that, in his heart and mind, the Heavenly Father had this plan already established. Think about that. The death of Jesus did not catch the Father off guard. No. He purposed it and he determined it long before it ever became a reality. Now, of course, the godless men who were there that day, that fateful Friday in Jerusalem, those godless men who carried out the murder are held responsible for their actions. They're not exonerated. But behind it all that we view on a human earthly level, behind all of that, God was carrying out his heavenly plan to pay for the world's sin with his son's innocent blood. This again is a mystery beyond my ability fully to understand. But God himself put his son to death for you and for me. In the second chapter of Acts, we see the disciple Peter preaching in the city of Jerusalem. And this was just a few weeks after the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. Now remember who Peter was. He was always the bold, impulsive one. Like some of us, Peter would always speak before he thought about what he was saying, and then later wished he'd never said that. He often acted impulsively, sometimes to the harm of other people, physically, and later was terrified when he realized what he had done without thinking. And Peter was sort of a natural leader of the disciples during the ministry of Jesus. But he was always impulsive. But you remember his actions the night our Lord was arrested? After they had been in the upper room and Jesus initiated what we know as the Lord's Supper that we will be observing in a few moments. And they left the upper room, went out across a little brook outside the city to the Garden of Gethsemane. There Jesus agonized in prayer about what was going to happen to him the next day on the cross. And then while they were there in the Garden of Gethsemane, the authorities come in, led by Judas Iscariot, one of the 12. Jesus is arrested, and he is taken through a series of mock trials that were a violation of the law, by the way, that day. And you remember Peter was hiding in the shadows of the darkness, watching Jesus from a distance. And then people started identifying him as one of Jesus' disciples. You remember that? And all of a sudden, Peter is just consumed with fear and terror for his own life and safety. And so when one after another person starts saying, I know you're one of his disciples. You talk like he does from up there in Galilee. And I've seen you with him. Peter started cursing and swearing. He was scared to death. And he actually said to one of those people who identified him as a disciple of Jesus that night, he said, listen, I'm not one of his disciples. I don't even know this man you're talking about. Think about that. That night was the lowest point of Peter's life. But just a few weeks later, God's Spirit has transformed and energized him. And so one day in Acts chapter 2, just a few weeks after the crucifixion and resurrection, Peter is standing in broad daylight in downtown Jerusalem. And he is preaching to the people of the city. And listen to what he said. This is the same man who cowered in the darkness, using profanity and saying, I don't even know Jesus. In broad daylight, in Acts chapter 2, he's standing, he's looking these people in the face, and he says this, speaking of Jesus. He said, this man delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed to a cross by the hands of godless men and put him to death. You were responsible on an earthly level. You were the ones who put him to death. He's standing looking these people in the eye, making those statements. But notice he said, even then Peter understood that all of this happened by the predetermined plan of God. There it is. And so, the Lamb of God, whom we worship and trust to save us and take us to heaven. The Lamb of God died a horrible death for all of us. Did he die in vain? Ask the thief on the cross, one of those men who died with him that day. He's hanging there, bleeding and suffering and dying for his crimes that he's committed. But he understands that there's something about Jesus that can help him as he dies and beyond. And so, while the other criminal hanging there on his cross is hurling insults and abuses at Jesus, this other man, also dying, says, "Please remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said, "Today you will be with me in paradise or heaven." That man could not get down off his cross. That's where he was going to die, just moments, maybe hours later. And yet, he knew that Jesus was not dying in vain, not dying for his sins or crimes. Did he die in vain? Ask all of us who've been saved by grace. The answer is obvious. Did his death accomplish all that was needed to rescue us from sin? Just before he died, Jesus made one last statement. Right before he drew his last breath on the cross, Jesus said, "It is finished." Actually, in the language that he spoke then, it was one word. Finished! And then he drew his last breath. That was a shout of victory, not defeat. Because you see, Jesus was saying, "I'm accomplishing, I'm doing all that needs to be done for the salvation of sinners everywhere. There's nothing that I or you can add to what he did on the cross that day. Our only response, the only thing we can do, is to put our faith in him and what he did there and nothing else to make us right with the holy God. It's finished," he said. Jesus endured all the suffering and humiliation of death like a criminal. He endured a horrible beating before he even got to the cross, called scourging. Did you notice in the verses that I read in Isaiah 53, the prophet uses that word, scourged? How did he know? He couldn't possibly know that 7 centuries later, the Romans, whom Isaiah knew nothing about, would control that part of the world, and they were the ones who carried out such executions as Jesus endured. Before a criminal condemned to die on a cross even got to the place of crucifixion, he was tied to a whipping post, and his back was stripped bare. And with a lash that contained bits of bone or steel, the prisoner was beaten unmercifully. Back was shredded and bleeding profusely. There were many criminals sentenced to die on a cross who never got to the cross. They didn't endure or didn't survive the scourging. Jesus did. And then the torture of the cross itself, which is beyond us to understand or comprehend. And yet, through it all, he never begged for the punishment to stop. He never tried to escape, though he could have. Even on the cross, the Bible makes it clear, Jesus could have called thousands of angels to release him, to end it all, to take him down from the cross, to end the suffering immediately. Could have, did not, never begged for the punishment to stop. The silence of the Lamb. All for us. That is what our worship through the Lord's Supper means today. And so at this time, I'm going to ask our deacons to come forward, and we will continue with our worship. As we come to this sacred and holy moment, remembering what Christ the Lamb has done for each of us, I would remind you that the Lord's Supper is intended for those who have accepted Jesus Christ as Savior and have been baptized. therefore you are invited to the Lord's table. In the days of Isaiah the prophet, whose words we read earlier, innocent lambs were presented in worship before a congregation like this, and the priest would take a large knife, and as the congregation watched, he would kill this innocent lamb. Now, I have to believe that there were some people, many people in those gatherings, who had very great sensibilities. That was hard to watch. That was hard to participate in. Think about it. And this happened over and over and over again. In fact, throughout the Old Testament period, hundreds of thousands of innocent lambs lost their lives in worship. They were sacrificed. This was not just to shock the congregation. This was to impress upon them the truth of how horrible sin is in the eyes of God. And so, later, another innocent lamb died for all of us. And the bread that we're partaking of represents his precious body nailed to the cross. We remember that body today. Again, in Isaiah's day, when those innocent lambs were presented before the congregation in worship and the life was taken from them, that was not the end. No, there was another part of the worship involving the lamb even after he died. The Bible tells us that the priest would take some of the blood from the innocent lamb who had been killed. He would sprinkle it on the altar before God and before the people. And here again is one of those great mysteries that we cannot fathom. Why is blood, the shedding of innocent blood, necessary? The New Testament says, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of of sin, no forgiveness. The life is in the blood. And somehow, the shedding of the Lamb's blood was necessary to satisfy the justice of God. Again, we can't fully understand it. We just stand in wonder and amazement at all of it and how a wonderful Savior could love us so much. The cup reminds us of the precious blood of the Lamb. Our hymn of commitment is number 234. We're going to be singing about this in conclusion. God is speaking to you about a decision you need to make, or if you need to come for prayer, this is your time. This is God's time. We will be singing prayerfully, number 234. Stand with us, please, as we sing.